Hi, I'm Martha, and I just went to the first session of NASCO, and I went to a workshop facilitated, well, lecture workshop thing facilitated by someone from the Albany Free School in Albany, New York. And that was a school started because this woman's son, Mary Loya, I think her name was, something like that. Yes. She was, her son was not doing well in school. He really hated it. He hated going to school. He was like completely depressed by it. And he's like, Mom, can I just not go to school? And she was like, sure, we'll just do it here. That's fine. Like, I see how school's not helping you at all. And so then his friends were like, you're not going to school? Your mom's just doing school? Can we just come over and just not go to school and go to your school? He's like, okay. And so then it was like 5 or 6 families, and then that grew to be like 15 families, and then they finally decided to like incorporate an actual school and get a building. And she got this building that was, what was it, an old, it used to be something else, and they got it for like $5,000 or something, something ridiculously cheap, and then she just paid for it, because it was in this sort of, this neighborhood that had gotten divided up by some projects from the government, and so everything was just disjointed, and so people were leaving, and so there were all these buildings that you could just buy. And so she did that, and now the school has 60 students, or 58 students, from K through 8, and they basically the teachers who are running it are more
battery.
You were just talking about the makeup of the school.
Okay, so there are 60 students between K and 8, well, traditionally what would be kindergarten through 8th grade. They are divided sort of into age groups, but that wasn't because the school had decided that. It was because the kids themselves wanted some sort of peer group to be with. It originally started out being like a one-room schoolhouse, no grade divisions. They also have, I don't remember if they have a preschool with it or not, but the younger kids have their own room on the first floor, but that is also becomes the lunchroom where they eat all together as a school at lunchtime. And they have a cook, and they also help prepare meals themselves. And they have started many projects. Like, to do a project, they've learned how to raise their own money for the projects that they want to do. So, like, some people wanted to they start mini businesses to raise money. So a group of kids were really good at baking, and so they wanted to have a baking club, but the ingredients were going to cost more than their food plan, or like the lunch plan could pay for. So they first used lunch plan food to make like cupcakes, these like apparently delicious cupcakes, and they sold those and got money to then buy their own ingredients to make more things that they could sell. And the teachers all have a like main area that they're interested in. Like, there's an art teacher and a music, like, person who does music, person who does, is the cook in charge of food. But they also have an age group that they work with everything. So their primary thing is what they're interested in, but then they also teach other things. They really also have a strong literacy program. They don't really have many like set things, but they really believe that reading is a big deal, and they want all their kids to be able to read and read it very well, and because that's a way that people engage in society. To get information and things, is a lot of it's through reading, so that's a big point that they have. And it's also something that their alumni have told them, and so they've changed. Because they used to not have one, and some kids were, like, really struggling when they went back into a mainstream high school, because they didn't have as good as reading skills as the other people in their classes. So they, like, the other thing school does is, like, talk to the people, like, talk to the students, how's it going, talk to former students, like, what could you have changed, talk to parents. There's also a, they have volunteer parents come, teachers, community members teach classes. So they have a parent group that teaches traditional math. They're all math geeks, and they really like it, so they formed a cooperative and volunteered that way. They also do things called virtual trips, where they a lot of the kids are from different ethnic backgrounds, and so they have immigrant people or people who have immigrated in their family. So they they pretend to be in a plane, and they all fly to whichever country they're doing, like I think Puerto Rico and other, anyway, and all these other places. Oh, Japan, they went to Burma, and then they make a dish that is in from that country and talks to the community member from that country coming in, talking about how their society is different. And just people get, they get exposed to different ways of doing things. One thing about the school that I really grooved on was that they, like, people call, anytime there's a conflict or someone wants to change things, they can call a meeting, like, and then people meet. It's like, there's room in the structure of the school that, like, that meeting is important, and you can stop everything and, like, talk about the issue that is going on between the kids or between, between the kids, something that's going on. The kids plan all their own events, sometimes renegade events that the adults don't even know about. And the older kids are in complete interaction with the younger kids. So, like, the eighth graders really have a sense of, like, we're the elders. Like, they're actually, the little kids are looking to us to be role models. And because they're in constant contact with younger kids and actually teaching them things, it really enforces that. Because in a regular school, you could say that to a lot of people, but because they're not actually in direct contact with anyone younger than them, like, it's really difficult to see that and feel that. And yeah, it just is one of the coolest ideas. And I was watching the presentation and listening, and I was just, like, looking at all the pictures, and I was like, I want to be there, like, in those pictures right now. And, like, I want to... And the guy was just, like, when he was giving the presentation, he would just go off on stories, and, like, you could tell he was, like, reliving being in that moment, and, like, he just, like, his whole body, like, he was just lit up all over, and, like, just talking about these kids, and, like, he's like, I didn't ever totally understand what was going on, but, like, wow, that was really awesome. Like, still don't get that game, but, like, someone wanted to give a seminar, and so we did that, and they went to the zoo, and the gorilla started a zoo, and the gorilla started having sex, and so then we had to have a whole talk about that, but, like, people were, like, super interested, and, like, it was crazy, but it was cool, and, like, like, all these stories, he just had the whole presentation was a storytelling event for him and us, so it was really cool.
Do they get funding through the state? Are they a public school?
They're a private school. Oh, that's another cool thing, is they're run on a sliding scale. So the students' families pay as much as they can of the tuition. And then, so if anyone wants to go there, they can. And the people are paid, like, the teachers who work there, they said they just get paid from whatever the excess is of after they pay their bills. So, like, it sort of they don't really know when their next paycheck is going to be a lot of the times. But they're so invested in doing it that the reason that they're trying not to get, they couldn't get public funding is because they don't follow a lot of the rules that you'd have to get public mm-hmm. funding. They don't have to take the tests. They don't have to, there's all these like structural compliance things that you'd have to do to, like, you'd have to report, do a lot more reporting on like where the kids are. And it's hard to be like, well, we went on this field trip, and they learned a lot, but you can't really
can't put that on the standardized test.
Yeah. So, and so that's the reason they're private is mostly because they want to be able to get around all these regulations that public or charter schools have to.
So how does the degree process work? It still applies as.
This is actually for any private school. They don't have as much regulations as a public school. They don't have to. They technically don't have to take the test. And he says it really depends on which state you're in too. Like in New York, it's like if you're a public or charter school, you have like way less freedom than you would as a private school. So that's the reasoning behind that. But they like stress that like.
10 seconds.
Oh, right. Okay. Well. Yeah.
Say goodbye.
Bye. Thanks for listening and.